How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. And I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servant, Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring a fatted calf and kill it, and let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. I want to use for a brief subject, it's always a good time to come home.
Amen.
It's always a good time to come home. At the very beginning of this text, we see Jesus with a crowd of tax collectors and sinners drawing near around him. This group of people had been following him since chapter 14 after hearing his sound teaching and preaching, and they continued to gather around. And when the Pharisees and the scribes saw the favor and grace that Christ was showing, they became distraught and they started discussing it amongst themselves, telling one another that Jesus is one who receives sinners. And we see in the text, well, throughout the whole Bible, that Jews had such a low regard for tax collectors that they even compared them with harlots. And in the 21st chapter of Matthew, we see Jesus ask the Pharisees and scribes a question. And after they answered, Jesus told them that even tax collectors and the harlots would even enter the kingdom of God before them, because even they repented and had believed after hearing John's preaching, and Pharisees didn't. But Jesus overheard them as they were talking. And as he overheard them, he used it as a perfect opportunity to teach from three different parables. The first being that of the lost sheep. Looking at verses 1 through 10, Jesus explains how someone has 100 sheep and loses one, and they leave the other 99 behind and go searching for the lost one. And he then goes on to say that when one is found, do we not get glad and go tell everyone that they might rejoice with us? He says there is more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who needs to repent than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. I can imagine the Pharisees still murmuring and talking amongst themselves. So Jesus said, you still don't get it. So he continues on into the parable of the woman with the 10 silver coins. He says, suppose that the woman loses one. Does she not clean the whole house looking for it? And when she finds it, does she not rejoice with her neighbors and friends? He says the same way does the angels in heaven rejoice over one sinner who repents. And that brings us to our text for today. We see three main persons in the text, the Father representing God himself, and the two sons representing us. One son is considered the sinner, always up to no good, and always mischievous. Some may even call him can't get right. And the other son is considered the righteous son who was always doing the right thing. We see the reckless younger son tell his father to give him his portion of his inheritance. He didn't have the respect to ask, but he gave a demand. That's how a lot of us do with God today. We demand things from him that are already promised through his word, but we have no patience to wait for it. Many of us, like the younger son, have very thin patience. And we also, like the younger son, could easily ask for things. He could have easily asked the father to give him a portion of what has already been set aside for him to see how he can manage it. But instead, he asked for the whole thing. And like many of us, he got greedy. And when the father grants us our request, we often take it and run with it. The text says that not long after the son packed up everything he had and left, like many of us, when we get what we want from God, we leave aside. We beg for things, and we make false promises. When what we beg for is fulfilled, we pack up our belongings, and we get ghost on God.
Yeah.
Not only did he get greedy, he became prodigal. How did he become prodigal? The text says that he spent all he had in wild living. I believe that if this parable was written today, it would go something like this. A young man from a small country town in Alabama received his inheritance and couldn't contain himself. He moved to the big city and got addicted to the wealthy lifestyle. He partied every night that he could. He bought himself a house. He drove the finest cars that he could buy. But he kept it up to the point that he went flat broke. The text says that after he had gone broke, that a severe famine came over the entire country and he was in need, even to the point of hiring himself out to a stranger to feed pigs. The text says that he was so hungry that he had a desire to eat from the pig's paws and that no one gave him anything. Somebody said it was fun while it lasted. Isn't it strange how after we blow through our money, after we blow through our blessings or savings, that the corners of times pop up in our lives? I remember a time I had just started working my very first job. I had no intentions whatsoever on saving my first check. I didn't want to budget it. I already made up in my mind that I was going to buy me some clothes and I was going to buy me some food. But instead of being smart and going to Walmart and getting me something for the house, I spent it on eating out every day. Other than that, I put a few dollars in church and everything else went to clothes. And one day, I got hungry. But lucky for me, I have three siblings, and they were nice to me. But the text says that nobody gave him anything. The next point the text says, when he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you.'" The text says he came to his senses. Snicker says, "You're not yourself when you're hungry." But I say that you're not yourself when you're greedy. But when you get hungry, your true colors will come out.
Amen.
When you're in your misery, when you're in the pen pig, it gives you time to come to your senses and think clearly.
Yeah.
In his clear thinking, he didn't think of how to improve conditions in the pig pen. He didn't blame his father. He didn't blame his brother. He didn't blame his friends or his boss or the pigs. He recognized his misery without focusing on it. And instead, he focused on his father. Might I suggest that when we come to our senses, that we ought not focus on the things of the past or our current situation, But we ought to focus on how good the Father is. We must focus on how the Father is our biggest support system. And we must realize that some of the situations we're in is not because God is testing us, but it's because we put ourselves in those situations with our mindsets and with our way of thinking. The songwriter said, without God, I would be nothing. Without God, my life would surely fail. And without God, my life would blow over. Just like a ship without a sail. He focused on the Father. He said, I will rise and go to my Father. Jesus didn't say that the man thought of his village or his home, but he thought of the Father. When the son returned to the father, he also came back to the village and to the house. But his focus was on the Father. We ought not focus on the people when it's time to turn back to God. If you focus too much on those around you, you'll lose your focus and what your attention should be focused on. If you focus too much on your surroundings, you'll lose focus of the goal, which is getting back to the Father. When he comes to his senses, we see him put together a plan. He practices what he's going to say to his Father. Oftentimes, we get like that ourselves. We know we haven't been doing what we're supposed to do, and we know we've strayed away from the Father. We stand in the mirror and practice our speeches. There was a time when I wasn't necessarily doing everything I was supposed to do in school. I received a bad progress report, and I practiced over and over in my head the excuse I was going to come up with. I thought to myself all the deeds that I could do around the house to get out of trouble. But I did all of that to try to keep her from getting a hold of me. But this son was much more truthful than I was. He was honest with himself, and he was honest with his father. Mm-hmm. It was as if he looked at himself and said, who are you? You're a mess. This is not who you're supposed to be or where you're supposed to be.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But thanks be to God that the only thing that he wants from us is a broken spirit and a contrite heart. Thanks be to God that he doesn't kill us while we're in our mess. Thanks be to God for an opportunity to come back home. The next point in the text says, he arose and came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. And I am no longer worthy to be called your son. I want to let you know that the Father is waiting where you left him.
Yes.
After he finished rehearsing his lines, the text says he got up and set out on his journey back home. He didn't turn back and let the guy he was working for know that he was leaving. But he got up and then left every little thing that he still possessed and left.
Yeah.
Might I suggest that we ought to be the same way when it comes to divorcing the sin in our lives, when it comes to letting go of past hurt and anger, and when it comes to letting go of any problems hindering our relationship with God. We need not go back to those dead situations to let them know that we're leaving, because all they'll do is try to drag us back and talk us back into staying. The text goes on to say that after he had started on his journey, that while he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and hugged and kissed him. The Father will meet you halfway when he sees you're coming. Not only will he meet you halfway, but he's meeting you with compassion and with grace. The text says that after the father and the son's embrace, that the son starts reciting his prepared speech. But the text goes on to say, the father instead of listening to what he had to say, he told his servants to bring my best robe, bring my ring, and bring some sandals and put them on his feet. In other words, I don't care about your sob story. I already know what you've been through, and you've had a change of heart and have made your way back home. Mm-hmm. And that's all that matters, and I'm glad that you're here. The Father knows your heart. He feels your sincerity, and the Father forgives.
Yes.
We then see him clothe the Son with his best robe, a ring and sandals. None of the items are necessity, but they symbolize the favor shown to him. I heard somebody put it this way, that it's God covering him with grace. Mm. That it's God fixing him up so nobody will see what he had been through or where he had been.
Yes.
And I'm sure the son had the same testimony as the songwriter. I'm glad I don't look like what I've been through.
Mm-hmm.
And in my closing, at the end of the text, it says, meanwhile, the older son was in the field. And when he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of his servants and asked him what was going on. And they replied to him, your brother has come home. And he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. And I'm going to leave you with this. You're going to have some opposition when you get back home.
Mm.
Count it not strange when it comes from the people that's closest to you.
Right.
The text says that it was his own brother. And his brother was angry. Everybody is not going to be excited about your return home.
Yeah.
But you can't focus on what everybody else is thinking.
Yes.
You have to keep your mind on the Father.
Yes.
And then that's where I want to leave you today.
Amen. 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 Amen.